وأقول في القرآن ما جاءت به آياته فهو الكريم المنزال وأقول قال الله جل جلاله والمصطفى الهادي ولا أتأول
الحمد لله رب العالمين له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين أما بعد Inshallah ta'ala, this is going to be our final and last episode on the series Al-Amnu min Makrillah, to feel safe and secure from the plan and the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In this last episode, I want to speak about being scared and frightened of your actions not being accepted. The believer lives this world believing that his actions will not be accepted. And we're scared, it's consistent questioning, is my actions accepted? He's scared. Whilst exerting the effort, he's also scared. Because to think your actions will be accepted and they have been accepted is basically you saying that you are pious. And that is not something you can reassure yourself. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says in the Qur'an, إِنَّمَا يَتَقَبَّلُ اللَّهُ مِنَ الْمُتَّقِينَ The ones who Allah tabarak wa ta'ala accepts their righteous deeds is the ones who are pious. It's the muttaqeen. None of us has the rights to think that of himself and say, I am a muttaqi. I am upon taqwa. None of us has the rights to say that. We don't know. Rather, we believe we are not from the muttaqeen. Our mother Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, she said, سألت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم I came to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم and I asked him about this verse والذين يؤتون ما آتوا وقلوبهم وجلة أنهم إلى ربهم راجعون She said, I asked the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم regarding that verse. What does the verse mean? قالت عائشة Aisha said, أهم الذين يشربون الخمر ويسرقون قال لا يا بنت الصديق ولكنهم الذين يصومون ويصلون ويتصدقون The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his wife Aisha asked the Prophet a question. She said, Ya Rasulullah, this ayah is talking about a people who do what they do and they are scared. So they do what they do. Does it mean that they drink alcohol? Does it mean that they steal wealth? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, لا يا بنت الصديق. That is not what they are. These people who do what they do are not drinking alcohol and they are not stealing wealth. ولكنهم الذين يصومون ويصلون ويتصدقون. Rather, they are the ones who are fasting and they are praying and they are giving their wealth in sadaqah. وهم يخافون ألا تقبل منهم. أُولَٰئِكَ يُسَارِعُونَ فِي الْخَيْرَاتِ وَهُمْ لَهَا سَابِقُونَ The Prophet said, they are the ones who are scared. That their actions will not be accepted from them. Their fasting will not be accepted. Their prayer will not be accepted. Their sadaqah will not be accepted. And then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, أُولَٰئِكَ Those are the ones who are hastening and rushing towards the good. وَهُمْ لَهَا سَابِقُونَ And they are the ones that are going to catch it. So ponder here, my beloved brothers and sisters. They are people who are working hard, exerting the effort. They're doing righteous deeds. And then they are scared that Allah tabarak wa ta'ala will not accept it from them. They're not committing crimes. And then they're scared. No, rather it's the opposite. They did righteous deeds, noble actions. And they are scared that it will not be accepted from them. There's a noble companion by the name of Amr ibn al-As. Amr ibn al-As is a noble companion. He was a qa'id. He was a general. And when Egypt was conquered by the Muslims, he was the first person to have ever run and govern the affairs of Egypt. He was the first governor appointed by Umar radiallahu anhu to run the affairs of Egypt. Amr ibn al-As is a noble companion and the father of a noble companion, Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As. Amr ibn al-As on his deathbed, when he became sick, وَأَحَسَّ بِدُنُوِّ الْأَجَلِ, and he felt that his time was coming to an end, he was about to die, tears came onto his eyes and he started to cry. وَقَالَ لِبْنِهِ, he said to his son Abdullah, كُنْتُ عَلَى ثَلَاثِ حَالَاتٍ, I was upon three situations. عَرَفْتُ نَفْسِي فِيهَا, three situations I've known myself to be upon. He said, the first situation, I was a disbeliever. I was not a believer. يعني كنت أول شيء كافرا. The first thing I was a kafir, a disbeliever. فلو مت, if I died, حينئذ, in that time, لوجبت لي النار, the hellfire would have been my final abode. I would have been from the dwellers of the hellfire if I died upon disbelief. فلما بايعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, the second stage is when I gave pledge of allegiance to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he said, at that stage, كنت أشد حياء, I was a shy, excessively shy person. كنت أشد الناس حياء, I was the shyest of people. منه, from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. حتى إني ما ملأت عيني منه قط, to the extent that I've never looked at him and filled my eyes with him. يعني I didn't look at him in totality. I'd always look apart, I'd look down, I wouldn't look at him salawatullahi wa sallam alayhi like that. Shyness of him. فَلَوْ مِتُّ, if I was to die, حِينَئِذٍ, in that situation, لَقَالَ النَّاسُ, the people would have said, هَنِيئًا لِعَمْرِ أَسْلَمَ عَلَى خَيْرٍ وَمَاتَ عَلَى خَيْرٍ, the people would have said, Amr took Islam in a good way and he died in a good way. Look how he turned it. He said, the people would say, the first one he said, I would have died upon disbelief. If I died of disbelief, I would have been from the dwellers of the hellfire. But when it came to how good he was as a companion, he said the people would have said, Amr took Islam in a good way and he died in a good way. And then look what he said, ثُمَّ تَلَبَّسْتُ بَعْدَ ذَلِكَ بِأَشْيَاءٍ, the third situation of mine, he said, is I fell into some shortcomings. I fell into some mistakes, he said. فَلَا أَدْرِي أَعَلَيَّ أَمْ لِي, will that situation be for me or would it be against me? ثم أدار وجهه إلى الجدار, and then he turned his head towards the wall and he started to say, اللهم أمرتنا فعصينا ونهيتنا فمنتهينا, oh Allah, you commanded us, we disobeyed you, and you prohibited us and we didn't stay away from it. And then he said after that, ولا يسعنا إلا عفوك يا أرحم الراحمين, and there is nothing enough for us and that will suffice us, oh Allah, except your mercy, your forgiveness, the most merciful. Amr ibn al-As, brothers and sisters, a noble companion, the Prophet praised him. He said, أَسْلَمَ النَّاسُ وَآمَنَ عَمْرٌ, the people have taken Islam. وَآمَنَ عَمْرُ ibn al-As, and Amr ibn al-As, he has become a mu'min. The other people, the Prophet affirmed for them Islam, and he affirmed for Amr Iman. What did Amr ibn al-As mean? The third situation, I fell into the shortcomings that I fell into. I don't know if it's for me or against me. He's talking about the fitna that took place between the companions and his role in that situation, radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. He is worried and he's scared about that particular situation, what happened and what took place. He's regretting it in his last moments in this world, radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. May Allah be pleased with him. The second person I want to mention is our mother, أم المؤمنين وأفقه نساء العالمين, the mother of the believers. And she is also the most knowledgeable woman in this entire world today. In the religion of Islam, there's no woman more knowledgeable than her. Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha. The Prophet loved her a lot. The Prophet was asked one day, Ya Rasulallah, his people asked, they said, أَيُّ النَّاسِ أَحَبُّ إِلَيْكَ, who's the most beloved person to you? He said, Aisha is the most beloved person to me. قِيلَ مِنَ الرِّجَالِ, what about the men? قَالَ أَبُوهَا, her father. The Prophet loved her and her father. صَلَوَاتُ اللَّهِ وَسَلَامُهُ عَلَيْهِ, he loved her, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Aisha was loved to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He was a righteous woman. She was the most knowledgeable woman in this ummah. She is the wife of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in this world and in the hereafter. When Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, she went out in the incident of Jamal, the day of the camel, and her aim and objective for that particular incident was to bring reconciliation. She thought and she believed that she has influence, that she's able to influence there to come a reconciliation. She left with that aim. She left with that objective to bring about khair and unity amongst the Muslims. She made her judgment. She made her judgment. Radiyallahu ta'ala anha. And she went. Radiyallahu ta'ala anha. She regretted that situation. Whenever she would remember it, she would cry about it. They said she cried so much that she would feel her khimar and her hijab, the tears that would come out of her. She even said to Abdullah ibn Umar, why didn't you stop me? Why didn't you not stop me? Because of that situation, she used to give so much sadaqah out, radiyallahu ta'ala anha. Her aim was good. Her objective were good. Her intention was good. She wanted to bring the Muslims together. But she regretted what she did, that she left her house. And she went about, especially when the people would ask her, Aisha, you went out and you left. And Allah said in the Qur'an, وَقَرْنَ فِي بُيُوتِكُنَّ وَلَا تَبَرَّجْنَا تَبَرُّجَ الْجَاهِلِيَّةِ الْأُولَى. When that ayah would be read on her, Aisha would cry and cry and cry. رضي الله تعالى عنها أم المؤمنين أفقه نساء العالمين زوجة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, the wife of the Prophet, في الدنيا والآخرة. She is. To the extent she said, رضي الله تعالى عنها, she said, because of what I've done, I am not going to ask to be buried in the house, you know, where her house, inside it, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and Abu Bakr and Umar were buried. She wanted to be buried with them, next to them. But what she felt was that she was not worthy anymore. She felt that she was not worthy of this anymore. So she said, I want to bury me in Baqi', where the other Muslims are buried. I'm going to be with the other remaining Muslims. Radiyallahu ta'ala anha. She didn't have in her heart, al-amnu min makrillah. She did not feel safe from the punishment and the plans of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, like many of us do. Like we have, without a shadow of a doubt. She accounted herself when she is a noble wife of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. The same with our companion, the companion Abdullah Amr ibn al-As, who we just took, a noble companion, a man who fought for Islam from internally and externally, noble companion, radiallahu ta'ala anhu. He was sad and hurt. Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As was his son. That itself is enough honor for Amr ibn al-As, to have Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As as a son. The man who heard the most narrations from the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. The third person I want to mention is Faruq hadhihi al-ummah, Umar ibn al-Khattab radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. A man whose virtue no one can get to it other than Abu Bakr. Umar is the second most honorable man in this ummah. ولذلك عبد الله بن عمر, he used to say, كنا نخير بين الناس في زمن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فنخير أبا بكر ثم عمر بن الخطاب ثم عثمان بن عفان رضي الله عنهم. He said, we used to choose between the people at the time of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. We used to choose Abu Bakr and then Umar ibn al-Khattab and then Uthman رضي الله عنهم. May Allah be pleased with all of them. So Umar ibn al-Khattab was second after Umar, after Abu Bakr. He was second. How was Umar radiallahu anhu? Umar was terrified and scared. He was scared when he meets Allah yawm al-qiyamah, what his situation is going to be. Umar radiallahu anhu came to Hudhaifah radiallahu anhu and he said to him, أَنْشُدُكَ اللَّهُ هَلْ سَمَّانِي لَكَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ. He said, I swear you by Allah, did the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam mention me with the hypocrites? Umar radiallahu anhu saying that to Hudhaifa. Umar said, to Hudhayfa. Hudhayfa was sahibu sirra Rasulillahi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Hudhayfa, he had the names of the hypocrites. He had each one, their names. So Umar radiallahu anhu came to him. And when Umar came to him, he said, did the Prophet name me? هَلْ سَمَّانِ لَكَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ. Did the Prophet mention me to you as the hypocrites? And then Hudhayfa radiallahu anhu, he said, لَا, no. وَلَا أُزَكِّي بَعْدَكَ أَبَدًا. And after you, I'm not going to praise anyone after that. Umar, a man who was promised Jannah alive whilst he was walking on this earth. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he writ for Umar to be from the people of Jannah. And he's so scared that he's asking his friend and the companion of the Prophet, Hudhayfa, whether his name is mentioned with the hypocrites. Us who have not been promised Jannah, we don't know where we're going to be that day. We don't know how our situation is going to be. We have no knowledge of that. And here we are walking and talking like we have been reassured and we have been promised. We don't come with the hope and the fear that we should. Brothers and sisters, wallahi, let's combine between the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the hope of Allah together and live our lives al-raja wal-khawf, hope and fear, consistently praying to Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, fasting a lot, combined between those two. The poet, he said, احذر عقاب الله وارجو ثوابه حتى تكون كمن له قلباني. Be cautious of the punishment of Allah and hope for the reward. وَرْجُ ثَوَابَهُ. Wish for the reward of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. حَتَّى تَكُونَ كَمَنْ لَهُ قَلْبًا. Until you become a person who has two hearts. In other words, in your one heart, have two cabinets. 50-50, hope and fear. Like you have two hearts. يَحْذَرْ عِقَابَ اللَّهِ. Stay away from the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَرْجُ ثَوَابَهُ. And hope for the reward. Allah is merciful, wallah. نَبِّ عِبَادِي أَنِّي أَنَا الْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ وَأَنَّ عَذَابِي هُوَ الْعَذَابُ الْأَلِيمُ. Allah is merciful subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah tabarak wa ta'ala is severe in His punishment. So fear Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. Be scared of Him. Hope for His reward subhanahu wa ta'ala. حتى تكون, so you can become كمن له قلبان, a person who has two hearts, a heart of fear and a heart of hope. It doesn't mean you have two hearts because Allah said in the Quran, ما جعل الله لرجل من قلبين في جوفه. You can't have two hearts. But what it means is that in that one heart that you have, you divide it fairly between fear and hope. Fear that necessitates righteous action, and hope that necessitates fear that necessitates staying away from the things Allah prohibited you from. And hope that necessitates righteous action. That's when it's praiseworthy. That your hope makes you do righteous action. And your fear makes you stay away from the prohibited things. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Rabbul Arsh al-Azim, the Lord of the throne. May Allah tabarak wa ta'ala make us from those who fear Him. And who also stay away from his punishment and that which will lead to it. Allahumma ighfir lana dhunubana wa israfana fi amrina wa thabbit aqdamana wa ansurna ala al-qawmil kafirin. Allahumma ighfir lana hazlana wa jiddana wa khata'ana wa amdana wa kullu dhalika indana ya rabbal alameen. Allahumma la taj'ali dunya akbar hammina wa la mablagha ilmina. ولا تسلط علينا بذنوبنا من لا يخافك فينا ولا يرحمنا. ربي آت نفوسنا تقواها وزكها أنت خير من زكاها أنت وليها ومولاها. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. سبحانك اللهم بحمده أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أستغفرك وأتوب إليه.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. How can you do a 2-second action right now that will give you a share of the reward of everything we're doing on this YouTube channel. Simple. Like this video and click subscribe. Why? It will allow YouTube to recommend our videos to other users. And imagine the huge amount of reward that could be waiting for you on the Day of Judgment if you did that with a sincere intention of spreading the Deen of Allah. You'll be rewarded for every single person who benefits from one of our videos as a result of your like or subscribe. That's an easy 2-second action that you definitely don't want to miss out on. Do it now, click like and subscribe, and don't forget to make that intention.